All right, I'm going to do a very, very important sermon here. Something the Lord revealed to me just the other day. I'm getting more and more and more emails, letters, contacts from you out there, just saying that you're having a hard time even keeping your head above water anymore. I mean, just it's getting so bad, having anxiety, just depression, and it's just like, what's going on here? How much more of this do we have to go through? And, you know, it's not, well, you know, brother, sister, you're struggling there with that sin and you need to give up that sin. You know, I could do that in the past. I mean, it was like, you know, are you having some struggles or whatever? These are strong Christians, very strong Christians. And almost across the board now, people that I'm in contact with, and you're going, it's weird. It's just like, there'll be days where I'm okay, but there's other days it's just like, I feel like I'm trapped and I'm going like, I don't know what to do. I'm afraid. I'm struggling with fear. I'm struggling with anxiety. I'm on the brink of just melting down, nervous breakdown kind of stuff. It's really weird. I've never experienced anything like this. That's what this study is going to be about today. The beginning of sorrows. Go to Matthew chapter 24. I'm going to show you what's going on. And I thank the Lord for showing me this, because this is really, really going to be a good study. Greatly encouraging. Dealing with the timing of the rapture. I'm not setting a date, so don't get excited. But let's look at this. Matthew chapter 24, verses 1 through 8. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, See not all these things? Verily I say unto you, that there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming, and of the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. It's the beginning. We're going to talk more about this stuff, but let's go to the parallel passage to Mark, or to Matthew 24, Mark 13. Getting a little tongue-tied here. Mark 13, beginning in verse 1. And as he went out of the temple, one of his disciples saith unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here. And Jesus answering said unto him, Seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. Now that happened, okay, 70 AD, Jerusalem fell. The second temple was destroyed. They're waiting to build the third temple right now in Jerusalem. Verse 3, And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives over against the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of when all these things shall be fulfilled? And Jesus answering them began to say, Take heed lest any man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Same thing we saw over in Matthew chapter 24. Now, this is another very interesting point that I need to make right here in Mark. A lot of the new versions are changing Christ to Messiah. Now, you say, well, Messiah means anointed one. Christ means anointed one. Yeah, but here's the problem. Messiah is a Hebrew word. The New Testament's written in Greek. And not one Greek manuscript out there, be it the Nestle's text, I shouldn't say manuscript, but text, the Nestle's text or the Textus Receptus, both use Christos, Christ. But then another part of the New Testament here, I forget the exact verse, you can look it up, but there is the word Messiah, okay, Messias, essentially. So to say, well, we can use the term Christ or Messiah interchangeably, no, you can't, if you want to be true to the Greek text that underlies the King James Bible and even the new versions. Nobody has the right to say we translated it as Messiah in this passage. You say, well, what's the big deal? Okay, what's the big deal? Think about it. What is a Catholic priest, according to the Catechism? They call themselves another Christ. Let me show you real quickly, just in case you're a little bit skeptical. Okay, there you have it. You see? The ordained priest takes the place of Christ. There's actually another place in here. Probably not going to be able to find it. Just flipping through. Okay, yeah. There's one of them. Okay, you have Christ, our high priest in heaven. Right there. The priest on earth, another Christ. Baltimore Catechism. There's all the stuff down there. This is recognized by the Catholic Church. So don't tell me, oh, we don't believe that way. Oh, we're Catholics, but we don't believe that way. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. You're in a satanic cult. You need to get out of it if you're a Roman Catholic. But you see, the warning Jesus gave directly points at Roman Catholic priests. Unless you change the word from Christ to Messiah. Because you see, they don't call themselves Messiah. They call themselves Christ. Yeah. Very important to stick with your King James Bible. Mark 13, verse 7. And when ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. Is that going on today? Yes. War games being carried out all around the globe. Japan sets sail with a new battleship, and this Iran's launching, nuclear things in North Korea. They're testing ballistic missiles, intercontinental ballistic missiles, and Russia's saying don't mess with this, and China's saying, hey, we're going to build our, missile bases in the South China Sea, and the Philippines is getting in on it, and America's, Israel's, hey, we just built this, Iron Dome weapon thing and all this. Wars and rumors of wars. Yeah, we're seeing it. Be ye not troubled, for such things must needs be. Well, if we, write our congressmen and whatever else, we can undo this thing. No, you can't. These things must needs be. These things are supposed to happen. It's Bible prophecy being fulfilled. Verse 8. Oh, well, let me finish verse 7. But the end shall not be yet. Okay? If you know Bible prophecy, the beginning of sorrows leads into the time of Jacob's trouble, which brings in the millennial kingdom, and then you have the end of the world after that. Verse 8. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in divers places. Earthquakes all over the place. And the U.S. Geological Survey comes out and they say, well, yes, it looks like there's an increase in earthquakes, but really it's just that our instruments are picking them up more. That's stupid. That's stupid nonsense. No, there are earthquakes hitting in places where no earthquakes have hit before. Old structures standing there for hundreds of years, and all of a sudden, earthquake, and the buildings are getting cracks in them and whatever else. Don't tell me, oh, well, the earthquakes were always there in this level of frequency, but we just couldn't read them before because we didn't have the instrumentation for it. Nonsense. Absolute total nonsense. And I heard something very interesting here. The Oroville Dam out there in California, the thing was, overflowing, and it's just this crazy thing. Just blew out the whole one side of the spillway and all this other stuff. And they said that whole reservoir back there, they dammed up the stream or the river that was coming into there and everything, and they said that whole huge reservoir, that's a lot of weight, and that thing is pushing down and stuff, and they're releasing water and they're doing all the stuff that's displacing a lot of that weight, and there's a lot of fault lines right out in that area. They could trigger an earthquake, and they're doing all this fracking all over America now, getting the gas, the natural gas, out of Marcellus shale, and there's different types of shale in the ground. Again, my home state of Pennsylvania, this is actually my home state now in Maine, but where I'm from in Pennsylvania, they're doing fracking all over the place. you know, drill an angled hole down in, and then they pump chemicals and water down in there and crack the shale way down, you know, thousands of feet down in the ground. And then the gas starts to leak out, and then they take the gas, and then, hey, natural gas, wow, this is wonderful. Making all kinds of money doing it. The politicians aren't about to stop them, you know. I mean, give me a break. Huge money coming from that whole thing. But guess what? You're putting cracks down in underneath all the bedrock and things like that, way down in there, triggering earthquakes. So it's not just supernatural that the Lord's causing these earthquakes and things to shake things up. It's actually man-made. So yes, there are earthquakes in divers places. And there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. Okay? Again, famines. Africa is just famines all the time. But I saw here not long ago that the UK was having up prices of lettuce and a couple other things because in Spain they're getting all these weird weather and whatever else, and they can't grow the vegetables and things. Yeah. The world food supply is very extremely fragile. And, you know, they're constantly trying to make more food with less ground and genetically engineer this so that the bugs can't kill that and all this other stuff. And that's leading to health problems. And they're putting antibiotics in the meat and stuff like this to pre-treat disease. And what's happening is people are just filled with antibiotics, and then it's creating genetic superbugs. And it's just, I mean, it's this world is a ticking time bomb right now. You say, well, this is the end of the world. No, not even close to it. This is just the beginning of sorrows. Now, let me ask you a question. Is it just Christians that notice these beginnings of sorrows? No. All people see these beginnings of sorrows. Lost people, they you know, I think we're going to come through it. I think everything's okay. You know, it's just like, are you insane? Do you realize what's happening to the planet? Do you realize what's happening with war and everything else? I mean, all these crazy nations are going to start launching nukes at each other, but we're going to come through it. Don't worry. If we just put aside our differences, you know, you can't put aside your differences. That's why God says separate, go into your different countries and stuff like that. You're not supposed to all be together. You mix everybody together, it creates war, you know, but lost people, they don't understand. They don't see it as the beginnings of sorrows. They say it's the end of sorrows. We're coming into a new world. I envision a new world, a new humanity. It's, yeah, you're insane. You're crazy. But as Christians, we know what these beginnings of sorrows are. You say, but brother, what's that have to do with how we feel and this anxiety and this depression? I'm glad you asked. Here's where it gets interesting. Turn back to Matthew. Chapter 26. While you're going there, so if you want to flip over, if you want to see the actual verse, which I strongly encourage, go to Philippians chapter 3. A very important thing that you need to understand as a Christian. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. One of the key scriptures for a Christian today. It says here that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Talking about Jesus Christ. As a Christian, you're supposed to know Jesus Christ. But look at this. And the fellowship of his sufferings being made conformable unto his death. The fellowship of his sufferings. What was one of the things that Jesus suffered with? Matthew chapter 26, beginning in verse 36. Let's look about this. Then cometh Jesus with them, and just pay attention here, okay? See if you can see where I'm going to be going with this, because we're going to be here in Matthew 26, then we're going to go over to Mark chapter 14. I'm going to read the parallel passage over there, then we're going to get into more detail. Just follow along and see where I'm going with this. See if the Holy Spirit can start to reveal some of the stuff to you before we go to Mark. But check this out. Matthew chapter 26, verse 36. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, Sit ye here, while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here, and watch with me. And he went a little further, and fell on his face, and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples, and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, What, could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, and for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then cometh he to his disciples and saith unto them, Sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. Turn to Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14. Verse 32. And he taketh with him, and they come to a place which was named Gethsemane, and he saith to his disciples, Sit ye here while I shall pray. Very interesting. Because what does the Bible say? Psalm 122, verse 6, Pray for the peace of Jerusalem, they shall prosper that love thee. We should be praying for the peace of Jerusalem. You see, because the church age is ending, and the Jews are starting to come back on the scene. All of a sudden, the persecution of Jews is ramping up more and more and more here in America. Interesting. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. The Islamic hordes over there that are saying, that are launching missiles at them now almost on a daily basis. The Muslim hordes over there that are saying, we don't want you building any more places for Jews to come over here and live. If America moves the embassy, U.S. embassy, from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, there's going to be all-out war. What are we supposed to do as Christians? Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Why? They shall prosper that love thee. I'm not preaching prosperity gospel. I'm not preaching you become a millionaire if you pray for the peace of Jerusalem. But what I'm saying is we should pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Christians, truly saved, born-again Christians, can't hate the nation of Israel. You can disagree with the government, you can disagree with the way that they attack Jesus and whatever else, but you can't hate the people if you're truly saved, if you're born again. Verse 33, And he taketh with him Peter and James and John, and began to be sore amazed. You know, I think that's a pretty good description of Christians as we look at this world right now. We're not amazed like, wow, this is really good. Wow, it's really... We're sore amazed. We're just like... It just takes your breath away sometimes. I mean, some of the stuff that goes on, you know, people that are saying they're not even man and woman anymore. I'm some kind of I'm binary or some... I don't even know some of these terms now they're coming out with. They're, you know, the pervert people out there are coming out with all kinds of things. I'm not man, I'm not woman, I'm not a human, I'm not of this, I'm not of that. I'm just I don't know what. We're sore amazed. We look at this world and it's just like, I can't believe that this stuff is happening. We're sore amazed. That I may know him, the fellowship of his sufferings. 2 Timothy 3:1 says, This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. Written to Christians. Okay? You say, well, brother, are you saying we're going in the time of Jacob's trouble? Oh, no. No, we're not in that yet. We're in the beginning of sorrows, which is the last days. Okay? Perilous times have come. Amazing. But look at verse 33 again here. And to be very heavy. How about that? Are you struggling with feelings of being very heavy? I'm hearing it from a lot of you. And I'm going through it myself. There's times I am very, very heavy, very, very down, very depressed. Romans chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. Paul says here, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. Yeah. You can relate to that if you're truly born again. If you're truly saved, yeah, you've had family members turn against you. You've had friends that meant something to you and they don't even talk to you anymore. You're lonely. You have health problems. Don't you? Verse 34. And saith unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful unto death. And what does he say? Tarry ye here and watch. I thought that was rather interesting. Matthew chapter 24, verse 42 says, watch therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. Speaking to the saints in the time of Jacob's trouble. Tarry ye here. Were the disciples Christians at this point? Mark chapter 14 or Matthew chapter 26? No. Jesus actually says to Peter at one point in time, he says, when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. They weren't converted. They weren't born again. That didn't happen until after the cross. Now, I believe that they were saved according to the way, an Old Testament Jew would have been saved, but these guys were Old Testament Jews. And by the way, when the crucifixion happened, they were all doubting it. They were all saying, oh, I thought he was the one. I thought Jesus was the one. And that, very interesting. So when the Lord says to these Jews, and that's what all of his disciples were, he says, tarry ye here. I just find that rather interesting. And they're to watch. Just like the Jews in Matthew chapter 24. Watching for the second coming of Jesus Christ. Verse 35. And he went forward a little and fell on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. Revelation chapter 3, verse 10 says, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Jesus Christ went through that hour, his time on the cross, to pay for our sins. He paid the full price on Calvary so that we don't have to. He became sin for us who knew no sin. Okay, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. His perfect life is imputed to us. He didn't escape that hour. But we will. Interesting. Ephesians chapter 1 talks about the purchased possession, the redemption of the purchased possession. We're bought with a price. We don't need to worry about having to go through God's judgment and God's wrath. It's a wonderful thing. Verse 36. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what thou wilt. Well, I can tell you, again, how can we relate to that as Christians? Because sometimes all you can do is just pray for the Lord's will. Sometimes you have done everything that you can. You aren't messing around in sin. You're reading your Bible. You're trying to witness to people. You're doing everything right. And things are falling apart. All you can do is just say, Lord, if you can help me get out of this, please help me out of this. But whatever you want, Lord, whatever your will is for my life, help me to get through it. Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 28 says, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Romans 8:28. Always remember this verse. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. It all works together for good, but can get pretty rough at times. And I'll tell you what, there's some times it's just like, it's so vexing. Verse 37, "And he cometh and findeth them sleeping, and saith unto Peter, Simon, sleepest thou? Couldest not thou watch 1 hour?" Who's sleeping right now? Romans chapter 11, verse 8 says, "According as it is written, God hath given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear, unto this day." The Jews, like the Jewish disciples before they were converted, the Jews of today have a spirit of slumber. They're sleeping. They're asleep. They have no idea. They have no idea what's coming. They just think, you know, they're all the, don't worry, the Anti-Defamation League, you know, the ADL here in America, or I don't know what you have in other countries, but here in America we have the ADL and, you know, the different organizations. That'll protect us. Don't worry. We'll be safe. And some of the Jews do understand that the time of Jacob's trouble is next. It's going to get bad for them. They understand some of that. Lost Jews that reject Jesus Christ. All right. But a lot of them are asleep. And the ones that do reject Jesus Christ, they understand the time of Jacob's trouble is coming, but they reject Jesus. They're asleep too. Only those that have put their faith in Jesus Christ as their Messiah, they're the only ones that are awake to what's coming, then truly understand what's coming. Verse 38, "Watch ye and pray, lest ye enter into temptation. The spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is weak." Who can give a good strong amen to that? The spirit is ready, but the flesh sure is weak sometimes. The spirit that's in a Christian right now, I think that we're all ready to want to have more chances to witness to the lost or want to see more people get saved and things like that. But boy, the flesh gets weak. You'll have sickness. That's weakness in the flesh. You'll have times where you get upset, depressed, and things, and sad, and whatever else. Yeah. The flesh is weak. And there's spiritual things, and there's all kinds of stuff hitting us now as Christians, and it's just like, you know, it's really something. Romans chapter 7, verses 24 and 25 says, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin." You will always struggle with sin, brethren. Do your best to fight it. Don't just give in and say, well, I'm saved. I don't need to fight the flesh. No. Don't do that. Always fight the flesh. But understand, you're never going to be perfect. You're never going to be sinless in this life. The righteousness of Jesus Christ is imputed to you. Okay, it's not going to come up. You're not going to get up to heaven. The Lord's going to say, hey, you know what? I looked at all the sins you did after you got saved. Sorry, you didn't make it. No, that's not going to happen. All right. Jesus Christ bought you. That blood is there. You've been purchased. All right. But you're going to struggle with sin. All right. Fight it as best you can. Let's read verses 39 and 40. "And again he went away and prayed and spake the same words." Do you ever kind of feel like you're praying the same things over and over and over again? You know? Yeah. Why? Things aren't changing. People's hearts have become so hardened now. You pray for relatives. You go, Lord, please pray. I'm praying for my uncle and praying for my grandfather, praying for my mom and dad, and praying for my brother and sister. And, you know, I just really wish. You find yourself praying the same words. Men's hearts are hardening. Verse 40, "And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, neither wist they what to answer him." Yeah, they're still asleep. Look at verse 41. "And he cometh the third time." The thirds. Read Revelation chapter 8 sometime. Look at all the thirds in judgment. Coming upon the nation of Israel, specifically. It's the time of Jacob's trouble. So Jesus comes, and he comes the third time. Thought that was kind of interesting. Verse 41, "And he cometh the third time, and saith unto them, Sleep on now, and take your rest. It is enough. The hour is come. Behold, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. rise up, let us go. Lo, he that betrayeth me is at hand. Now you read that, you say, wait a second here. Sleep on now, take your rest. Rise up, let us be going. You go, that doesn't make any sense. Why would Jesus Christ say to his disciples, sleep, take your rest, rise up, let's go? What's going on there? There's a deeper meaning. You knew I was going to say that, didn't you? Notice Jesus does not say, take our rest, or let's all rest and think. He says, take your rest. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 5 through 10 says, ye are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night, nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for an helmet the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Notice the distinction. Lost people, specifically who this time period is for, that's coming up. The body of Christ doesn't need to be purified. The body of Christ doesn't need to have tribulation from the world to convince us that Jesus is the true Savior and we accept him. We already know those things, okay? This time period that's coming is for the purification of the nation of Israel. They've been brought back in unbelief, exactly as the Bible said would happen. Brought back in unbelief to their land. The nation of Israel has been reborn. Okay? We don't need to go into that time period. They, on the other hand, are asleep right now. They are asleep mostly to the fact that Jesus Christ, their Messiah, has already come. They don't really understand all the arguments and things like that. And Satan has raised up Roman Catholicism down through the centuries to make the average Jew think, well, that's Christianity. It's not Christianity. If you're Jewish and watching this, as I've said in many other studies, understand Roman Catholicism is not New Testament Christianity. New Testament Christianity is a Jewish religion founded by Jews. Gentiles got saved, but predominantly Christians now today are Gentiles, but the fact is, it's a Jewish religion. And truly saved, born-again Christians that believe the Bible were not anti-Jewish. The Roman Catholics are the ones that hate the Jews and say you have no right to that land over there. Very, very important to understand that. But that's why that there's a distinction there. The Jews, those disciples that aren't even converted yet, Jesus hasn't died on the cross, and Jesus says, take your rest. He's giving a prophecy. You take your rest. But what does he add in there for people that get saved later on? An interesting statement, actually. He says there in verse 42, rise up. Let us go. Rise up, let us go. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. You see all the elements there? Jesus says in Mark chapter 14, verse 42, rise up. 1 Thessalonians 4:16, rise. 1 Thessalonians 4:17, up. His words are right there. Why is this going to be such a wonderful thing for the body of Christ? Because we're told to comfort one another with these words. Who needs to be comforted? People that are suffering. That I may know him and the fellowship of his sufferings. You know what we're feeling right now, brethren? The Lord's given us a little taste of what he felt. Our souls are heavy. We're sore amazed at this world. We're just going, I mean, it's not even close to being able to, we can't reform this world anymore. Christianity can't turn things back around. It just, this world's gone. It's only, all we can do right now is just try to tell people, anybody listen, get saved. There's not much time left. Oh, I think things are going to work out. Well, you're crazy. You're crazy. You're living in a in delusion. If you think that things are going to work out on this earth, even from a scientific perspective, just forget the Bible, forget prophecy, forget all that stuff. Just look at this world scientifically. Look at things like geoengineering. Look at the fact of the Gulf oil spill thing, and there's all this toxicity and things, and animals dying, record, millions of fish washing up on the shore, and birds dying all over the place, and earthquakes all over the place. War about ready to be triggered at any minute. All these people with their fingers on the nuclear war, buttons and stuff. You don't even need the Bible to realize that this world is about ready to just self-destruct. Christians are sore amazed. We're looking at this thing, we're going, we're having anxiety. We're just going like, Lord, why? I don't understand. He's getting ready to say, rise up, let us go. We're close. You say, well, brother, when would you? I don't know. It could still go a few years. I don't know. But I want you to remember this. When you're feeling those days where you just think to yourself, I don't know if I can keep going on. And you're just like, God, please. What's wrong? I just don't understand. You're experiencing what Jesus Christ experienced. Very interesting. You see, Jesus Christ came to his own, and his own received him not. He came to die for the Jews, to be the Savior, the Messiah for the Jewish people. And guess what? The time of Jacob's trouble, it's about the Jews again. So that hour that Jesus Christ experienced, right when he's there in the Garden of Gethsemane and he's feeling all that pressure upon him, we're going right back again to that. That's why we're feeling it, brethren. You know, I lived as a single man for 36 years, and the Lord brought me my wife, and he did that for a reason. I would have lived a single man the whole way up through and everything else, but the Lord had to teach me some things. And he taught me through marriage and through having a son as well. And, I can tell you right now, there are times when my wife is suffering or when my son is suffering, and it hurts me. It hurts me very much to see them in that suffering position and to know that they're down and whatever else. It affects me. Well, in like manner, as Christians, our husband in heaven, he's suffering right now. We're feeling it. And we're real close, brethren. Those Jews, tarry ye here and watch. Sleep on. You're not waking up? Okay, sleep on. Blindness in part has happened to Israel. Not total blindness. There are Jews that can get saved. If you're Jewish, you can get saved. See, but my family, let them sleep. Let them sleep. There's nothing you can do. But here's a really interesting thing. Because again, we have another proof of a catching away of the bride of Christ before the time of Jacob's trouble. You ready? Check it out. Verse 42. Rise up, let us go. Okay? Lo, he that betrayeth me is at hand. Who's he talking about? Verse 43. And immediately while he yet spake, cometh Judas, one of the 12, and with him a great multitude with swords and staves from the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Judas Iscariot. See, I don't understand, brother. I don't get it. He that betrayeth me is at hand. John 17, verse 12. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Jesus didn't lose any of his disciples except for one. the man that he said, one of you is a devil, not possessed with devils. One of you is a devil. And here in John chapter 17, verse 12, he calls him the son of perdition. John 13, verse 26 and 27, Jesus answered, "He it is to whom I shall give a sop when I have dipped it. And when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. And after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then said Jesus unto him, That thou doest, do quickly." How do you spell sop? S-O-P? Son of perdition? Satan entered into the son of perdition. That thou doest, do quickly. Just 7 years. Thousands of years. Babylonian mystery religion culminating in the Roman Catholic system. And just 7 years for the final kingdom. And not seven very successful years either, I might add. That thou doest, do quickly. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 through 9. "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth will let, until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders." Satan entered into the son of perdition. Jesus is in the garden. He tells the Jews, "Take your rest. Go on, sleep. You don't want to wake up? Sleep. But rise up." To the Christians, "Rise up, let us go." Why? "He that betrayeth me is at hand." The son of perdition. We're close. How close? I don't know. But the feeling that the body of Christ is now having, you know, like I said, at first it was like just a few of you and stuff, and we were starting to feel this weird, just, you feel like you're trapped. You feel just like, I don't know how to get out of this thing. I don't know how much more of this I can take. Well, you're experiencing the fellowship of the sufferings of Jesus Christ. And pretty soon he's going to be saying, "Rise up, let us go." The Antichrist is going to be revealed. And the Jews are going to wake up. And they're going to realize what they have to deal with. I thank the Lord that he went and he died on that cross to pay for my sins and your sins if you're saved. I don't have to enter that hour. And I don't have to enter into the hour of temptation, because I keep God's words. Just a simple book. You can take my book from me. You can burn it. You can try to destroy this book. And you might destroy this copy, but you'll never destroy this book. This book spread out. This great book. I hold in my hands the greatest book that's ever been written. This thing is so far superior to the original autographs, the original manuscripts. It's not even funny. What an amazing book we have that tells us how to be saved and that leads us into the truth. And this book tells us why we're feeling what we're feeling, why we're feeling that anxiety. Be encouraged, brethren. Those feelings of depression, those heavy feelings of sorrow that you're going through, we're in the beginnings of sorrows. The church age is ending. It's going to be time to leave very soon.